President Trump's comments on the death of four brave Special Forces soldiers in Niger is another reminder of our nation's continual state of disgrace under his administration. Trump's actions tarnish and permanently stain the reputations of all who carry out his orders. Honorable people, many who have served and sacrificed in duty to country their entire professional lives, some that have parented other patriotic souls lost to this world in service to country. A state of disgrace which includes past personal attacks on Gold Star parents and now politicizing the death of fine men. Men who died protecting America's interest. A president that felt free to use their deaths and the death of his chief of staff son as a defensive tool to deflect questions about why he had not made public comments on their sacrifice or the details surrounding the October 4th action resulting in their deaths. Trump also pointed a finger at the usual suspect, President Obama, disgracefully and inaccurately stating that if you look at President Obama and other presidents, most of them didn't make calls. According to the New York Times, Mr. Trump's assertion belied a long record of meetings Mr. Obama held with the families of killed service people, as well as calls and letters, dating to the earliest days of his presidency. Before he decided to deploy 30,000 troops to Afghanistan, President Obama traveled to Dover Air Force Base in Delaware to greet the coffins of troops. In the current state of disgrace, all service to Trump must stop, putting country first by speaking out in rejection of his unacceptable actions. Will Generals McMaster, Kelly, and Mattis fall victim to President Trump's graveyard of falsehoods, or will they stand up to this historically unpopular, unwavering and overreaching president? McMaster, Kelly, and Mattis may feel that they are the guardians of the Republic from positions of power, but as long as Trump is enabled by others leaving him in control of our military, the enablers are derelict in their duty. They are failing their pledge to protect and defend our country from all enemies, foreign or domestic. Those serving must pay the debt to the fallen by upholding their oath. What will it take for Americans to reject Trump and his administration? What will it take for the patriotic, honest, and heroic public servant to end service to Trump and party for service to country? What will it take the Republic in ashes, destined to become a contemporary Greek tragedy? The Trump project has failed. Crashed and burned on day one. The flames have only gotten larger, more destructive, threatening all in their path. I respect that many, not a majority, had a thirst for change, but the rainmaker elected to drain the swamp is disrupting everything American, creating only desert in his wake. Trump stated the killed soldiers knew what they signed up for, but when it happens it hurts anyway. These words are a reminder to all that Trump is not fit. The direct result of the electorate's inability to differentiate and understand messages of hate and division from fact. The current political state is a byproduct of the hyper-information age used to exploit and weaken the fabric of democracy, highlighting America's continual struggle with race, religion, guns, and other social issues. The effects of technology have enhanced divisions in which compromise is interpreted as weakness, creating a political environment reminiscent of the Cold War acronym MAD, Mutual Assured Destruction. WWI is a reminder of the devastating impacts to a civilization not in touch with technological advancements. WWI residual consequence, World War II and the influenza epidemic of 1918 resulting in the deaths of 20 to 50 million people worldwide. With one bad decision or defensive impulse while boxed in by events of his own making, Trump has the power to inflict much greater casualties. Russia, Mueller, and North Korea top the list of issues that could give way to unintended consequences resulting in irreparable damage to America and our way of life. Duty calls to those who serve, help to end our country's state of disgrace under Trump. Some Northern Californians who feared the worst for their pets in the wake of this month's deadly wildfires are getting some welcome good news in recent days: their animals survived. Animal shelters and veterinary offices have been posting photos and videos of numerous heartwarming reunions between pet owners and the animals they feared were lost forever. Many of those reunions involve cats. That's because when people are fleeing at a moment's notice, cats are typically more difficult to wrangle than dogs. It's harder to find cats in that kind of stressful situation, Karen Blount, a veterinarian at Windsor Animal Hospital in Santa Rosa, told HuffPost. More often than not, they bolt. Many people tried their hardest to take their pets with them, but became separated at the last minute. Jennifer Trabuco told HuffPost that she and her husband noticed smoke pouring into their Santa Rosa home at around 1:30 a.m. on October 9. "We only had about 7 minutes to get out of our house," she said. Her husband grabbed their three kids and dog while she found and scooped up their two cats, Jake and Luke, in her arms. "Right as I got outside, the cats kind of panicked," she said. "Luke squirmed out of my arms and I was screaming, 'Oh my God, no.' The two cats tore off in different directions. Jake went back into the house while Luke disappeared outside into the night. She ran back in and got Jake, but with flames bearing down and children and other pets in tow, she had to make the heartbreaking decision not to search for Luke. "It was so smoky that my husband lost sight of our road," she said. "My three kids in the back seat, and they were crying because our cat got left behind. I was crying. But Luke's story has a happy ending." Days later, the family got a call from Sonoma Humane Society. Luke was injured, but alive. His microchip, a tiny implanted device that allows vets and shelters obtain an owner's contact information, helped rescue workers find Trabuco. Trabuco was so happy, she burst into tears. Luke's whiskers and ears were singed and all four paws were burnt, but he's recovering and is clearly happy to be back with his family. "He's been glued to us and purring," Trabuco said. "All he wants is to be held." Bizarrely, this is the second fire Luke and Jake have survived. Trabuco adopted both as kittens after a fire destroyed the patch of trees and grass where a feral mother had given birth to them. Other reunion stories shared on social media include a woman whose cat broke out of her carrier during an evacuation, and another whose cats leapt out of the car when she rolled the windows down only slightly for ventilation. The Sonoma Humane Society told HuffPost that more than 550 domestic animals are still reported missing. And dozens of animals have been found and treated for injuries, but their owners have not yet been located. Sonoma Humane Society, Sonoma County Animal Services, UC Davis School of Veterinary Medicine and Marin Humane Society are among many groups accepting donations online for animals affected by the fires. Blount said Windsor Animal Hospital is also accepting donations for a fund to help cash-strapped pet owners pay their veterinary bills in the wake of fires. Those donations can be made in person or over the phone. The Sacramento Bee has a comprehensive list of other organizations both for animals and humans in need of donations and volunteers in the wake of the fires. If you have lost or found a pet within Sonoma County, you can use a centralized online database that is shared between all shelters and rescue groups within the county.